Good evening. Welcome to the High Museum. I'm Susan Crawley, curator of folk art. We're delighted to have as our guest Dr. Joyce Cohen, who teaches art history at Simmons College in Boston. She teaches a popular course on contemporary art and a course on women in art, which focuses on women as artists from medieval times to the present. Dr. Cohen has had a long-time interest in self-taught artists, especially, as she says, the women. Most recently, she presented the paper Historians in Aprons about Clementine Hunter and Gaylene Aiken at the American Folk Art Museum in 2007. Dr. Cohen is also an advisor to the Foundation for American Self-Taught Artists in Philadelphia. Tonight, Dr. Cohen will discuss with us Nellie Mae Rowe's depiction of the theme of house and home, a theme that was actively denigrated by modernist critics and militantly challenged by feminists of the 1970s. Today, many female painters, sculptors, photographers, and installation artists have reclaimed this subject matter as the very rich territory that Nellie Mae Rowe always understood it to be and had made it her own. And just as a side note here, if you haven't already done so, please visit the folk art galleries on the fourth floor of the Stent Wing of the High and see Dr. Cohen's installation in the Nellie Mae Rowe Room, which she put together to coordinate with her talk tonight. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Joyce Cohen.
Hi, everyone. Before I start, I'd like to thank Susan Crawley for inviting me here. We've been talking about this for some time, and it took a little work to schedule it. You have such an active museum and education program. It's really fantastic, and so it's wonderful to finally be here. I'd also like to thank Susan's staff, who worked to send me JPEGs and make arrangements for my stay here, and I think also to plan that rainstorm yesterday when I arrived, just so I'd feel at home. I heard that you've had quite an active weather winter. I'd also like to thank Jay Weiland, who I hope is in the audience. Is he here somewhere? Who kindly gave me permission to use some of his photographs in this talk. And also Judith Alexander Augustine, who also contributed some photos that you'll see tonight. I'd also like to thank Xenia Zed for her many emails back and forth. It's a little daunting, I have to say, to come to Atlanta and talk to an audience who probably knows more about Nellie Mae Rowe than I do, and people who actually knew her. This is a talk that grows out of a long interest in self-taught artists, but also is colored by my experience teaching at a women's college about women artists. This will be a rather personal talk, a consideration of Nellie Mae Rowe's work in relationship to the theme of house and home, a theme that runs through American art from the quilts and samplers of the 18th and 19th centuries to the present day. You've probably all heard the phrase, anonymous was a woman, which was coined by Virginia Woolf. And I just wanted to repeat those words before I started as a reminder and backdrop for this look at Nellie Mae Rowe's work. Although many of you here tonight know well the story of Nellie Mae Rowe, I'd like to review a bit of it first. Many have commented on the irony of her birth, the fact that she was born on the 4th of July, 1900, Independence Day, the first year of the 20th century. She was the ninth child of a sharecropper family descended from slaves. The littlest sister, she often escaped from the hard work of the fields and bundled the family laundry into dolls. She tied the heads and drew faces on them. Whenever possible, at the end of the day, She loved to lie on the ground, on the floor, and draw. As an adult, Nellie Mae Rowe frequently spoke about the fact that her parents both made things with their hands. Her father was a blacksmith and basket maker. Her mother sewed dresses for her daughters, made quilts, and taught these crafts to her children. They were also a family of storytellers. Although Nellie Mae Rowe attended school for 4 years, from her earliest days, her lifelong education would be in her own hands, both figuratively and literally. Like many young women of her social class, she married young, at age 16, to escape a life of hard field work. She hoped for something more. As a wife, she did housework at home and also worked as a domestic. I believe there was some field work in there as well in those first years. When her first husband died, she remarried. But then at 48, she was widowed again and on her own. At this point, she lived in the small house that she and her husband had built, that she and her second husband had built in Vinings. She had no children, a fact that she regretted all her life, although she did have close relationships with many of the children of her siblings. At 48, she famously declared, "I ain't fooling around no more. No more cooking, no more marrying. I'm going to get back to play in my playhouse. I decided I kept house long enough. I don't want to be bothered by no one, except myself." In recent years, a growing literature has documented how women in different countries and historical periods found inventive ways to negotiate the limitations of their times and to forge identities as artists. Their stories, from the medieval cloisters of the 12th century to the 20th century, share notable features. Their creativity extends to both their art and to their social circumstances. Against remarkable odds, women have managed to become artists when they had few role models, when they were denied education, and when they had little support from their societies. Nellie Mae Rowe explained that she had always wanted to be an artist, but didn't have the chance. Later in life, she reflected that now young people today have choices that she never had. Although Rowe continued to work for another 30 years after her husband's death, before she was able to retire, she used her spare time for creative activity. The house that you see here became both an actual home and a metaphor. She embellished interior and exterior spaces and also made dolls and drawings. Over the 43 years she lived here, the house was her studio, a central image in her art, and an idiosyncratic display. Nellie Mae Rowe's embrace of play has been characterized in many reports of her life, but often without the context that explains the power of her independence, as well as the deep memory that she had of her little girl self, the child who began to discover a special identity through drawing and making dolls. Play was an important psychic touchstone that directed Nellie Mae Rowe for her entire life. She rejected the roles available to someone of her race and social class, and the dichotomy between work and play was especially poignant for an African-American woman in Rowe's historic moment. A relatively new book called Labor of Love, Labor of Sorrow, Black Women, Work, and the Family, written by feminist historian Jacqueline Jones, has offered a compelling analysis of how working class black women in the mid-20th century, despite the changes brought about by post-war industrialization, were virtually excluded from improvements in work life. Their possibilities remained domestic service and childcare in other people's homes, or the lowest level jobs in factories and fields. Play for Nellie Mae Rowe was a felt way toward a felt way forward for a resourceful and religious woman. Later in life, she spoke about the gift God had given her and the need to fulfill his mission for her through her art. Doll making and drawing were ongoing as early as 1950, whenever she had time, but it appears that the yard was an early improvisatory enterprise. The garden was always there and constantly evolving, deeply engaging and a distraction from loneliness. I kept busy, she said in later life. I first started hanging things in trees and bushes in my yard. I put a wig on a head and sometimes have a shawl hanging from it. It looked like a person sitting up in the tree. I'd color with lipstick and crayon. The color would fade, but I like it when things keep changing because it keeps me busy. People would bring her things and she would transform and incorporate into the yard in an inventive form of relational aesthetics. She seemed to collect people in the same way that she collected stuff, as she called it. She recycled everything and scavenged for interesting material. Imagine what it might have been like to give this lady cast-offs of things that she might find useful in her creative effort, and then to witness their incorporation into her installations. In fact, there are some people here tonight who did have that experience, who knew Nellie Mae Rowe, and did give her things, and also were given things by her. In 1971, a young Judith Alexander Augustine created a unique record of Nellie Mae Rowe's yard and playhouse when she was a student doing a photography project at Boston University. Judith explained that her mother passed Nellie Mae Rowe's house every day and was the one who suggested that they just knock on the door. Later, her aunt, Judith Alexander, would come to represent Nellie Mae Rowe in her Atlanta gallery. I think it's clear enough so you can read the text. This is a short tour of Nellie Mae Rowe's yard using Judith Augustine's photographs. I just learned tonight that I didn't use one of her favorites. I'm sorry, I'll have to come back and do another talk. What's obvious from these pictures is the dynamism and visual excitement of Nellie Mae Rowe's yard in 1971. Growing things, making something out of nothing, recycling, and transforming the meaning of fragments of life were the animating force of this environment. Like many dressed yards of visionary artists throughout the South, Rowe attended to the boundaries of her property, decorating fences, thresholds and doorways, and situating guardian figures at entry points. These are all hallmarks explained by Gray Gundacker and Judith McWillie in a 2005 book called No Space Hidden about yards and environments. This is a wonderful book, by the way, if any of you are interested to track it down. Other scholars have described how cultural and religious values were often expressed in these environments and how found and transformed objects assume a special spiritual power in many aspects of African American culture. Nellie Mae Rowe's interventions were often fragile and therefore temporary, causing her to make constant additions and adjustments. It's an enterprise that kept her busy, she said, and she told Augustine that she would need to put one of her chewing gum dolls, in the Frigidaire for a while before it could go back out and survive in the sun. The yard, like the dolls, had to be nurtured. Thomas McElvey writing about yard environments, notes that these installations are not only subject to the continual alterations, by their makers, but they're also subject to the weather, constantly decomposing and returning to the earth. In their acceptance of organic processes, yards like this manifest a balance between the interventions of culture and the subjects of nature, and the cycles of nature. All this, of course, makes the destruction of Rowe's playhouse after her death all the more tragic, but photographs do capture moments in an enterprise that evolved over decades. They freeze frame Rowe's inventiveness and capture what Xenia Zed has called a deconstructionist's paradise in the yard. Judith Augustine's visit and the notes she took that day also provide a lovely example of what others who knew the artist describe as her generosity and eagerness to have her work seen and appreciated. As I mentioned earlier, Rowe's approach foreshadows the popularity of participatory art projects and public art of recent years, where viewers play a role in facilitating the meaning of an artistic space or event, and the artist is part enchantress and part hostess. Although Nellie Mae Rowe would probably have cared less, she was ahead of her time. It seemed that people regularly brought her things and helped keep her vision going. Despite the fact that there were neighborhood tensions in the early years and the yard was repeatedly trashed by passersby who called her a fortune teller or hoodoo, she remained open to visitors who came to see her playhouse and to photograph it. "I just gained friends," she said. "I like living on the side of the road." I have to say that for someone who wanted to be bothered only by herself, she had a lot of visitors. Over 800 people signed her guest book between May 27, 1973 and March 15, 1975. In 1975, Rowe's house was listed in the American Institute of Architects' Guide to Atlanta, and apparently people came to visit in buses. It's worth noting that there are surprisingly few documented yards like this by women, and even fewer large-scale environments. John Beardsley's catalog of visionary sites explains this gender difference partly on the basis of economics. Men, he says, might be more likely to own their spaces or to feel empowered to embellish a rented plot. Additionally, these yards represent a form of public address, so men may feel more entitled to this public voice, a sense of male prerogative, perhaps. Neither of these appear to apply as drawbacks for Nellie Mae Rowe. The house was hers, and she was not a shy woman, reluctant to express herself. Oops. This remote has a very delicate touch, so I have to get used to it. Inside 2041 Paces Ferry Road, another changing creation unfolded. After looking at Jay Weiland's photos, I turned to a recent book called The Saturated World, Aesthetic Meaning, Intimate Objects, and Women's Lives. The author, Beverly Gordon, draws from women's history and the study of material culture to examine interiors, collecting, scrapbooking, and doll making, all activities associated with women and previously dismissed as subjects of serious study. But Gordon has also applied this notion of saturation, a world of high sensory intensity and texture, an overflowing world that engages all the senses, to the consideration of vernacular environments and self-taught yard installations. Her idea of the saturated environment is useful in considering Nellie's inside and outside playhouse, a densely embellished woman's space, and an evolving artwork. As living space, studio, and display, Nellie Mae Rowe's creation is multifaceted, but it's cohesive. Like the yard, the interior spaces are alive and in flux. Gordon describes the impulse to compound sensual aesthetic intensity in a highly personalized way as an important creative act. Going beyond the conventional scholarship of art hierarchies, she describes the human impulse to make things special, one that transcends materials, race, class, and is found in both professional and amateur pursuits. When Rowe incorporates elements, recycled and transformed objects, gifts of stuffed animals, family pictures, pictures of her own dolls, as well as the actual dolls, she's crafting a world, her world. There are religious icons, art reproductions, posters and calendars, and images of her personal heroes, like Martin Luther King, alongside her own drawings. You'll notice the poster of the King March on Washington. She's crafting meaning and reflecting her concerns, and I might say building an identity, making a kind of large-scale scrapbook of her life. She actually signs this wall, posting a signature. I'll show it to you in another slide, not these details, but one coming in a minute. Did she think of it as a monumental drawing or installation artwork that says, this is mine, I'm connected to all this? What about the many table installations around the house? Aren't they connected sculptural tableaus, living still life art? Another compelling idea from Gordon's work is the notion of embodiment. She uses the word to characterize the way creators are physically as well as psychically involved in making and remaking their spaces. Embodiment speaks to the creative way that things are touched, moved around, guided by a personal vision, rather than placed based on abstract or strictly informational logic. Nellie Mae Rowe was an artist creating a world, not an interior decorator. Embodiment is most obvious with the dolls. They're everywhere, inside and out. And they include manufactured dolls that float in the upper reaches of the room, as well as Rowe's own hand-sewn dolls seated on chairs and couches. They keep company with her. They're intimate objects, extensions of the body and the self. Just look at this. The children of the photographer Jay Weiland made multiple visits to Nellie's playhouse, and on this day in 1977, everybody gets to hold a doll. Through these photos, viewers also get to participate. We get to play too. It's the nature of this aesthetic to encompass the viewer, to draw us in. Finally, we can't forget that the interior is a workspace, a studio as well as a dynamic display. In this collage shoebox, Rowe has incorporated photos, photographs of her space, along with images of herself working, an act of both recycling and self-representation. Now, one of these has the signature. I don't know if I can find it. Well, trust me, it's there. It's great that you get to see these big, at least I was looking at them with a magnifying glass. She made many drawings, of course, and many of you here are familiar with her drawings. Not surprisingly, images of the playhouse are embedded in drawings related to all of Nellie Mae Rowe's major themes: storytelling, spiritual matters, current events, her life as an artist, and the meaning of death. At night, things come to me. This delightful drawing here shows the playhouse as living space and studio. The artist shows herself in bed. Visions hover overhead. I see what I draw in my mind at night, she said. I can see everything like that. I don't care how crazy it is. I'll probably draw it. She saw her process as unique, saying in multiple interviews that she didn't draw like other people. I can sit right now and look down on the floor. I can see something. It looks like something I could draw, and I'll draw it. This statement sounds amazingly familiar. It's very similar to what the European surrealists in the early 20th century who said. They sought to discover imagery about the unconscious mind by bypassing the censoring mechanisms of logic in order to discover forms that transcended the rational. Nellie Mae Rowe, who said something almost exactly like Nellie Mae Rowe's statement, I go to bed at night and dream tomorrow's paintings. André Breton described what he labeled a poetics of the unconscious, beyond the control of reason. Visions induced by trance and dream states were the fuel of surrealist invention, and they passed their prescriptions along to the abstract expressionists like Arshile Gorky and Jackson Pollock. Being true to such a process, however, can yield results that even the artist can't explain. Apparently, Nellie Mae Rowe resisted pinning down the precise meanings of her drawings. And while she loved to talk about herself, it said that she could become quite testy when pressed for direct explanations. It is what it is, she would say. Engaging with this work requires that the viewers surrender themselves to her special incongruities and juxtapositions. She manages a very unique tension between the literal and the elusive. This drawing may be a double self-portrait. She shows us the sleeping Nellie and maybe the artist awake on the other side of the room, perhaps ready to sketch the dream before it disappears. The visions floating above the bed are familiar ones, the dog, the rooster, the birds, the figures, one whole figure and one a hybrid, a mythological kind of creature that appears elsewhere in her work. They're very much the visitations that crop up in dreams, in diverse cultures, and many storytelling traditions. Playhouse shows the artist at home, drawing what appears to be a tree of life, while outside the garden is filled with activity and low-hanging fruit, has attracted birds, a dog, and a pig. Is this a tree of life or a feeding frenzy about to happen? Rowe's drawings are always about more than one thing. She frequently represents creatures competing for food, which has been interpreted as a warning against social greed and exploitation. The house is a triumph of patterning and decoration. She imports elements of African-American quilting designs and symbols. Her signature, something she enjoyed experimenting with, also for decorative effect, is large and extravagantly drawn. Here the artist's house is combined with that of her dealer and friend Judith Alexander. Both homes are colorful and decorated with patterns from quilting. But as always, there's a larger message in the representation of the architecture. Xenia Zed, who knew both Rowe and Alexander and is here tonight, has written that this fusion of the houses amounts to paying the highest visual compliment to Alexander, a woman who would ordinarily be considered an outsider in Rowe's world. It expresses Rowe's desire to protect and enmesh her friend within her own personal and cultural universe. Portraits appear above each house, although the homes themselves are stand-ins for each woman. No feminist worth her salt would allow this lecture to pass without mentioning the importance of Judith Alexander in promoting Nellie Mae Rowe's work and helping to give this artist a place in American art history. In 1978, Alexander met Nellie Mae Rowe after seeing her work in the show Missing Pieces, Georgia Folk Art, 1770 to 1976, Nellie Mae Rowe's first significant exhibition. Alexander later collected, cataloged, conserved, and promoted Rowe's work for many years. The importance of women as dealers, collectors, and founders of cultural institutions in the 20th century is legend. A growing literature on women's leadership in the arts underscores the way individuals and institutions have historically influenced culture. The pioneer conceptualist artist, Joseph Kossuth, who specializes in deconstructing the institutions of art, has noted that it's never the artist alone. It takes the collector and the curator, as well as the artist, to make the art visible. From women leaders like Isabella Stewart Gardner and Gertrude Stein to Peggy Guggenheim and Marcia Tucker, the first woman director of the Whitney Museum, the history of art would be incomplete without these individuals and their special relationships with the artists. Many of you know a great deal more than I do about the efforts of Judith Alexander on behalf of Nellie Mae Rowe. But just by looking at this work, it's obvious that they had a friendship of trust and affection. This is two friends sharing a girly moment. It looks like Nellie Mae Rowe may have just had her hair done. The phrase, "Lord, we love you," and the sketch of the Tree of Life off on the side are messages that all humanity is connected. Rowe obviously liked the photo so much, she enshrined it in this specially ornamented frame made from a styrofoam tray. And of course, there's the Judith Alexander doll. Variations of the Tree of Life appear in many drawings. Some are titled The Garden, others The Family, as Nellie Mae Rowe exploits this common Christian theme. Like many artists, she seems to conflate the tree of life, symbol of life itself planted by God in the Garden of Eden, with the tree of knowledge, a tree from which Adam and Eve ate the forbidden fruit. This one is ambiguous, I think. Are the figures among the branches the family from whom all generations were born, or are we seeing Adam and Eve in a classic composition from Genesis? And if so, who is the tall figure on the right? A self-portrait of the artist, perhaps? There are many self-portraits in which there are many self-portraits among Rowe's drawings and demonstrate her tremendous range and variety. This, too, is a hallmark of women artists who are inventive about developing an identity for themselves. She loved to paint vegetation, flowers, and flowers arrayed in huge pots or growing in the yard, and as others have pointed out, dogs and other animals are everywhere. Another self-portrait is perhaps a double self-portrait. She shows herself walking in the garden in either a mirror to help her with the portrait or with her reflection, or a finished and framed artwork floats along beside her. Her gifts as a colorist and the pleasures of embellishing an image are evident here, as well as her pleasure in nature's beauty. These drawings share a device that seemed to become more common in the late 70s and 80s, where a small image of a house contains the artist's signature, a kind of chop mark in the lower corner here and here. Perhaps a way of using the playhouse as a stand-in for herself. Of course, there's a lot else going on in these drawings, but for the purpose of time, these are just two more examples in which she's using that chop mark device where the house sort of becomes the self. In this drawing, the house is once again a special container of meaning. It looks perfect, an orderly, well-lighted space. Bill Arnett suggests that the blue roof may derive from an African-American belief that blue wards off evil, and that the brown pig is a stand-in for the artist who is otherwise not at home. A skeletal-looking white dog stands before a tombstone, a clear message that death lurks outside the playhouse. Also from 1981, this drawing is believed to have been created soon after she learned she was suffering from cancer. The empty chair as memento mori is used elsewhere and participates in a long art historical tradition of using a familiar domestic object as a metaphor for death. While the house is filled with activity, the artist is not visible. An angel, the black dog, and the dying plants reinforce this feeling of death. Greedy birds move in to eat the fruit when no one's home to shoo them away. In an indirect representation of the self, here the artist appears as protector of the innocent. We see a woman's hand, symbol of feminine wisdom. Nellie Mae Rowe spoke often about her hands. God put me here for something, she said. He took got everybody here for something. That's the reason he let me live this long. There's some work I need to do before he take me. I ain't done my work, what he wants me to do. That's why the talent he gave me to do this work, he gave that to me, because I don't have no children, and he gave me something to do. The hand appears in multiple drawings. In a remarkable assertion of artistic immortality, she says, when I'm gone, they can see the print of my hand. I love that. They'll see the print of her hand. I'll be gone to rest, she said, but they'll look back and they'll say, that's Nellie Mae's hand. As this artist was creating her yard and garden and fusing her personal image with images of house and home in a growing body of drawings, she was unaware of the significance of the fact that she was creating work in a highly contested realm of American art at a crossroads in its history. Since the 1940s, abstraction and formalism had grown in dominance, while the subject and material of everyday life declined. In the 50s, the influential art critic Clement Greenberg, spokesman for a new American avant-garde, declared that any art that was not purely about color, line, and the flatness of the picture plane was not art, it was kitsch. Storytelling, symbolism, and representation, they were out. Art by women that reflected their daily lives was discredited by a powerful, male-dominated art world of critics, curators, collectors, and the artists themselves. Women's work, especially that rooted in traditional crafts, was awarded a secondary status. Even in architecture, early notions of house and home suffered in the face of modernism's clean lines and stark white cubes. Rigid categories separated art and craft. Get ready, this is going to be a change of pace. When I started studying art history as an undergraduate in the late 60s, we used the leading textbook of the time, which had over 1,000 artists in it. Only one of them was a woman. Mary Cassatt, an American who had been denied professional training in America and moved to France where she worked until her death in 1926. However, when we came to the chapter on Mary Cassatt, it seemed that the only thing that made her worthy of study was that she was friends with Renoir and Manet. And she had close relationships with the other Impressionists. Critics in the 50s and 60s declared that avant-garde art had to be an art of abstraction, minimal shapes, fields of color, and geometric forms. Of course, there were a lot of women artists working in the early to mid 20th century, but many functioned on the margins of the mainstream art world. One exception, this is just a little footnote of interest, given the current political discussions here in the country. One exception were the years of the WPA, when artists were part of the stimulus. During the WPA, artists were employed in colorblind and genderblind projects funded by taxpayer dollars. The WPA projects hired near equal numbers of men and women, and a very high proportion of a much higher proportion of African Americans and Native Americans than could be found in commercial galleries or museums at the time. In 1948, as Nellie Mae Rowe was declaring dedication to her playhouse, the African American Faith Ringgold, born and raised in Harlem, talked about applying to art school, but was told to forget it. There were no black women artists. She was told to apply to teachers' college, and maybe that way she could teach little children about art. Lee Krasner, who did manage to study art at the Cooper Union and the National Academy of Design, as well as at the Art Students League in New York City, earned the dubious praise from her teacher, the famous Hans Hoffman, that her painting was so good, and so good, in fact, that it could have been made by a man. In response to modernism's hierarchy of high and low art and the systemic exclusion of women, in the early 70s, feminist artists mounted an offensive that began in California at Fresno State College and Cal Arts and quickly spread across the country. Led by Judy Chicago and Miriam Shapiro, the feminist art movement challenged the art establishment's rejection of the content and practices associated with women's work and daily experience. The artists and students that Chicago and Shapiro gathered around them in a cloistered setting in California sought to subvert discriminatory practices of the studio, the gallery, and the museum, and to confront the bias of critics and historians who had systematically left women out. They critiqued patterns of male authority and tried to recover the histories of female artists. Their most visible product was the creation of Woman House, where the art students and their teachers took over an abandoned house in LA, saved it from demolition, and turned it into a collective studio, performance, and exhibition space. Miriam Shapiro, who had used fabric of all kinds in her art before, collaborated with Sherry Brody to create doll house rooms. Sandy Orgel and Faith Wilding also made room-size installations that focused on the imprisonment that women felt in their domestic roles. They made art about the structure of marriage and women's roles, and they protested the absence of women's art in museums and galleries. But beyond subject matter, one of the most lasting legacies of this movement was to reclaim practices associated with traditional crafts and the use of domestic imagery in art. For the first time since the advent of modernism, visitors to Woman House saw knitting, crocheting, and quilting, what one critic called the soft, the sewn, and the stitched. These were combined with messages about the real lives that girls and women were living. Part art showcase and part political statement, Women House opened the door for a higher consciousness about institutional exclusions in the art world. In short, this group of teachers and their students launched a movement that rippled through the 70s and into the 80s with the emergence of new feminist publications, exhibition spaces, and organizations like the Women's Caucus for the Arts. Miriam Shapiro launched the pattern and decoration movement that included both men and women, by the way. Oops. And Judy Chicago created the dinner party in collaboration with over 400 women artists and craftspersons, celebrating women artists from history, Artemisia Gentileschi to Georgia O'Keeffe. Louise Bourgeois, who had been working in New York since the 30s, surfaced with drawings that directly reflected, images of house and home, paintings that she'd actually hidden away for years. According to Bourgeois, she'd suppressed these works created in the 1940s because, in her words, "I knew I'd be ridiculed." Back then, no one wanted to look at stuff like that. Throughout the 70s, a heightened multicultural awareness and attention to both sexism and racism empowered activists like Faith Ringgold, who began making dolls. She did actually manage to become an artist after 20 years of teaching. Began making dolls and quilts that were simultaneously political statements and beautiful domestic references. Ringgold and other African American artists confronted the absence of black women in the art world and supported each other in making objects that reflected their African American roots. The leading feminist art critic and advocate for women artists, Lucy Lepard, in a recent publication, has lamented the fact that while feminist artists of the 70s were rediscovering their mothers' and grandmothers' strategies for survival through beauty, marveling at quilts, china painting, hooked rugs, embroidery, and other homemade treasures, they should have also been discovering women who made paintings, sculptures, and yard shows in a vernacular context. But at that time, self-taught artists like Nellie Mae Rowe were overlooked by most of their contemporaries in mainstream art. Imagine what first-generation feminist artists might have learned from women like Nellie Mae Rowe, or Clementine Hunter, or Bessie Harvey, Sister Gertrude Morgan, or Gaylene Aiken. It wasn't until the Black Folk Art Show at the Corcoran in 1982, in which Nellie Mae Rowe was one of only three female artists among the 20 represented, that her work began to receive national exposure. It opened just a few months before her death, but by then, the discovery of a rich vocabulary related to house and home, something the 70s feminists had fought so hard to bring about, had already been underway for 30 years. At 241 Paces Ferry Road. She actually received some recognition from the Guerrilla Girls in 1985 with this poster. In her work on self-taught artists, the scholar Judith McWillie has pointed out how the important 20th century synthesis of African art and European traditions, heralded by shows like Primitivism in the 20th century, at the Museum of Modern Art in 1985, and typically credited, in a movement typically credited to Picasso and Matisse for their discovery of Africa. In fact, McWillie argues this innovation had already been accomplished by untrained African American artists in the South, as they combined elements from an African past with unique American styles. I would argue in a similar way that Nellie Mae Rowe's playhouse and drawings also prefigured a revolution in art. The representation of women's lives using the materials and processes of everyday life. There will not be another Nellie Mae Rowe, so we can only hope that with greater visibility for self-taught artists, the importance of their work will become better known. Also, that the barriers between mainstream art and self-taught artists will continue to dissolve. I would love to see more museum shows with mainstream artists and self-taught artists side by side, accompanied, mind you, of course, by scholarship that recognizes and respects the deep significance of each artist's origins and contexts, scholarship that, and exhibitions that will give women artists like Nellie Mae Rowe their rightful place in American art. Thank you. Okay, I'd love to try to answer any questions that you might have or hear any comments that you have. I really, as I said, I feel like I'm coming into Nellie Mae Rowe's hometown, and I'd love to learn more about her, and this is the beginning of a process for me.
The slides, those are the ones that you chose for your presentation here?
Yes.
I just wasn't too clear about that, the particular ones.
Mm-hmm. I tried to, you mean of the drawings?
Yes, yes. Mm.
I tried to show examples that covered the territory of how she represented the house in the drawings, how she represented herself in relationship to the house, and how she represented herself in relationship to the garden. Yes, this is this. I had 45 minutes, so that was.
You did not see them.
No, but there are many. There are many other examples on all of these themes, and some that you may well be familiar with.
Can you talk about how you found Nellie Mae Rowe, and your first impressions of her, please?
Well, as Susan mentioned in her introduction, I'm personally interested in self-taught artists, and particularly the women. I have been for some years, and I've known about her work for a while. I've been to presentations where I think some that Susan has given that I've seen her work actually a few years ago here, and in other collections. I'm on the board of a foundation for American self-taught artists. I hope you'll go to the website and look at it, and you'll find Nellie Mae Rowe there. And this is a foundation that I'm an advisor to them. It's a foundation that is trying to archive film footage on self-taught artists to collect some of this fragile material that isn't going to last very long. Excuse me, and we've also made our first film, a 53-minute film on James Castle, the self-taught artist from Boise, Idaho. So in the process of gathering material for the Foundation for American Self-Taught Artists, I did read about Nellie's Playhouse. And so Susan was kind enough to let me see the film, and that kind of sparked the idea of this theme, which I hope it came through in such a short time, but it so richly connects with the history of art that it really made me feel more convinced that these artists' work should be better known and should be shown within the context. I mean, it's amazing, really, that she was doing the kind of work she was doing while in another part of the art world, people were fighting for permission to be able to do that kind of work. Not precisely her kind of work, but real work that was about their lives and that used the materials and crafts that she was interested in.
During her lifetime, what kind of income did Ms. Rowe realize from her artwork?
I'm sorry, I didn't...
During her lifetime, what kind of money or income did she realize from her work?
Oh, I'm sure there are people here that can answer that better than I. Maybe Susan.
She wasn't recognized nationally until 1975, and she was 75 years old, so it wasn't that much of her life that she was recognized as an artist.
During her lifetime, I'll just say. I think the income might have eluded her during her lifetime, and I'll just leave it at that.
Yes, I think that I would assume that that's the case. And also, I hope it comes through that I think the part of the art that she needs to be recognized for is not really saleable art. It's ephemeral, and it's gone. It was that amazing yard and those little things that sometimes fell apart after a couple months. And not just the individual objects, but the enterprise that she was engaged in, which is really quite phenomenal. I'd like to ask the family and other people who visited her what you saw of her process of adjusting things, adding things, changing things. Can you introduce yourself too? Because it's wonderful that there are family members here. And
yeah, I'm Ken Brown. My cousin Kathy, Bob, my aunt who was, you know, she was our great aunt, but her aunt. But we all knew her. And my sister Darlene, and. You know, to grow up with Aunt Nellie, you know, you just, it was magical. You know, you talk about things falling apart in your yard. We never saw that, you know. I mean, nothing ever fell apart. It was like an amusement park. As a child to grow up and go play in her yard, you know, it was, her sister would take us over, and I look so forward to it because you could just reach in a tree and pull out a car and play in the yard. It was, you know, I mean, looking at the pictures inside of her house, I just remember sitting on the sofa with the room with all the dolls around it, but we didn't think anything any different of it. We would sit and, yeah, it was normal. We would sit and watch television with her. She loved wrestling. We would watch wrestling.
Yeah.
And we didn't realize what type of greatness we were in the presence of, but it was a very magical place. And to sit here, I asked my cousin, I said, I wonder what Aunt Nellie would say today if she could see all of this. But you did a fantastic, I really enjoyed this presentation. It was...
Thank you.
It was, I was there. It was all of a sudden 1965 and I was playing in the yard again. And she was a beautiful person and, you know, besides all of the notoriety that she's gathered over the years, you know, she'll always be Aunt Nellie to us, and she'll always be, you know, you would have had to live it, you know, you can't really explain it, but yeah, thank you for the presentation. It was beautiful. Thank you.
You're very welcome. I'm going back to the picture of the house because there was something which I had wanted to mention in my talk and somehow missed the chance to squeeze it in, but it was actually a story that Jay Weiland told me about these orange windows on the house that apparently a film crew came to film her and covered the windows with an orange gelatin paper in order to adjust the light levels inside the house. And she liked it so much that she kept it for months or maybe even years. And when I was going over the slides earlier, Kevin, who's somewhere up there and who's an artist, said what is really, really true. She was an amazing colorist. And here she is. These are complementary colors on the color wheel. I'm sure she never looked at the color wheel or could care less, but she's managed to combine two colors that artists who are trained in color theory know snap together. And she was an incredible colorist. And, you know, I had a great, a telling conversation with someone earlier this evening who said, you know, I love the drawings, but I don't always understand them. And I hope you'll go away feeling that that's pretty okay, because there's a lot there, and it is a kind of rapture of the deep. And some of the parts of the drawing are really partly about, oh, I just started making this, and then, boy, I just got into doing this and doing that. And that's something artists know about, that just the sheer, Xenia has in one of her articles a line that says something about the sheer pleasure of a beautiful line.
I wanted to ask if you could talk more about the artists that influenced her, because the time period in which she lived, there were some major art movements, particularly among African-American artists, and I'm wondering if she responded to Harlem Renaissance artists, any artists from the WPA, or any artists coming out in the 60s from the Black Arts Movement and things like that. I'm just curious to see, would like to know if you know any information about how these different movements and artists impacted the work that she did.
Well, there, I see a lot of head shaking over here in the center. I asked Jay in an email if he ever saw her looking at any art books, because there are some self-taught artists that do go to the library, look at art books. I think you should go ahead and say what you think, but my impression is that she was influenced by her unconscious. I mean, there was a lot, she had an amazing mind. And those descriptions of how she worked and where her ideas came from. Now, you know, some people don't believe that there is such a thing as a collective unconscious, but I was just at the Rubin Museum a few weeks ago in New York, and I saw the Carl Jung Red Book. You know, he was the psychologist, a colleague of Freud's, who really developed the idea of the collective unconscious, and it was a notion that at some level, below the logic and reason and so on, we all are tapped into ideas, images, visions. That's why, you know, you can go to a bookstore and open a book on something like circles, and you'll see circles from Indonesia and circles from Australia and circles from 600 years ago and circles from last month by artists, and there are common themes. So I think that those were some of the things she was influenced by. There isn't a lot written about the family life, about her parents, and except that they were great storytellers. Music also. I mean, there just wasn't time, but if you've ever seen the Nellie's Playhouse, the DVD film, you see her playing. She had two electric organs, one in each room. And she loved singing, she loved gospel music. Maybe that gave her some visions.
I have a question. Did anybody, any of her family members want to elaborate on that question about her? When everybody was vigorously shaking their heads, did anybody want to say anything else about her looking or not looking at other artists' work?
I don't think she did it from the perspective of setting out to become an artist. I don't think that was ever in her mind. From my experience with her as a child until her death, it was always about the joy of doing it. And it was as though all of this was just inside her and had to come out. And I don't think it would have been a situation where she saw anyone else's work and was influenced, but perhaps maybe past experiences or things of that nature might have influenced some of the things that she did, but it was truly from her spirit. And I think that she knew that and she believed that, which is why she mentioned the fact that it was a gift from God. And I think that's pretty much what it was.
I think she did, she certainly did like it when people responded to her art. But she probably was a little surprised at people's enthusiasm for it as well, because as you say, she wasn't setting out to, although I did read in one of the transcripts of one of the interviews that she said something about, it isn't really a drawing until somebody comes and takes it away. Which is part of why I got interested in this whole idea of relational aesthetics. And I didn't mean to put in a jargon word, but there's a lot of art today which is involved with artists who kind of have an idea that they set in motion, and it pulls other people into it so that, and maybe she was referencing something like that.
Several stories came to mind just hearing these questions. And when I first met her in 1971, I remember, and going into her house, you asked what was her process like. And at that point, she didn't think of herself as an artist at all in those days. You know, she was just always creating. And being with her was just watching her, she was always in motion, moving from one vignette to another and rearranging things and sitting down at her organ and playing a little bit of music and then moving on to something else. So that was what it was like to be with her, for me, and I think probably I'm not alone in that. And a couple of other memories, going to New York with her when she had her show at the gallery in New York, I can't remember the name of it. Betty Parsons Gallery, maybe it was. It was the first time she'd ever been out of the state of Georgia, except once she'd gone to Chattanooga, I think. But needless to say, she'd never been on an airplane. And the thing that impressed her the most, she told me, was the way the clouds looked from the air. That really impressed her. And we went to the Guggenheim Museum, and everybody was all, oh, isn't this wonderful, Nellie, you know, walking around. And she wasn't very impressed with that. She said that she'd been in a place like that before, only that place you went and your skin turned blue. Oh. And we were going, what could that be? And it turned out it was the Polaris Lounge on top of the Hyatt Hotel, which, you know, and I thought, everybody was blue. You know, everybody was blue, and that made an impression. And the other thing was walking around at Judith's gallery, I would just sort of follow her around when she had a show and listen to what she was saying to people. And the same drawing, she would always say something different. It was whatever came through her at that moment. She never claimed to have any control really over it or any thought over it. It was all inspiration. And she has passed that on.
Yeah,
in
and
a beautiful way.
I think what you're saying is exactly why I went from the drawings to the interiors and to the yard, that it is that process of kind of moving from one thing to another and kind of a process, and they're all connected. You don't know where one piece stops and the other one begins. And by the way, this is Judith Alexander Augustine, who did, she looks awfully young for having gone to college way back as.
Thank you.
And also, Jay Weiland, could you just stand up also? And you know, these photographs are treasures.
Right.
Yes, she drew from the television set.
Of the wrestlers, and so as far as artistic influence, it was life.
Mm-hmm.
She
right.
just was constantly enjoying life, and my children loved her so much because she had enough sense to remain a child until the day she died.
Yeah.
And children see right, you know, right to the heart of that.
A
about the chewing gum sculptures. She told me that a fly had flown into her mouth once, and there was this constant jumping in her head, and that she chewed chewing gum to keep the jumping down. And when she was done with it, she'd put it in what she called the Frigidaire until she was inspired to pull some out and make a sculpture out of it, and that's where the chewing gum sculptures came from. Is that right?
As a young 20-something new to Atlanta, I guess I was too naive to know that I was viewing the crossroads of American self-taught art, but I did know every time I drove by her house, it made me smile.
Hi, a little broader and different question, but as an art historian who enjoys self-taught art, how do you think the museums and the art world are going to treat self-taught art 25, 50 years from now?
This is actually a huge question, and one of the reasons why I like the Hive Museum so much is because you were one of the first museums in the country to really, first of all, collect self-taught art, and then to show it, to have it around, to be able for people to be able to see work from one part of the world and then go downstairs and see Nellie Mae Rowe. There is, this is a diversion, but it's kind of a funny thing. There's a blog on the internet kept by somebody who, I don't think she works here now, but used to work here in the museum. If you're in the audience and you're this person, please raise your hand. But they were the person talks about being on duty in the corridor near where the Nellie Mae Rowes were displayed, and she loved them so much that she'd created a whole kind of combinations based on a Nellie Mae Rowe drawing, and then she'd match it with a textile design. And if you Google Nellie Mae Rowe, after a bit, that will come up. Also now, if you Google Nellie Mae, you get a picture of me, which is a little amazing. I take it as a complete honor, but to answer your question, this is something that Susan Crawley could also certainly speak to. I think it has to be, I'm a fan, and this is quite controversial, of showing self-taught and trained artists side by side. I mean, even the language, some places call it outsider art, vernacular art, and so on and so on. I think that there's just so much to learn by seeing this material in its historic context, not kind of off on one silo. But it has to be done well, and it has to be done right. My caveat about the research that really appreciates the origins of these artists. There have been some exhibitions where the material is mixed, and they haven't been very good, and some that are good. In the future, I think museums are going to be competing for this material, because I think it's already really starting to change. Just with the announcement of this talk, I got half a dozen inquiries from graduate students who are doing research on artists, a couple of them on Nellie Mae Rowe, one on Sister Gertrude Morgan. I don't think you would have found that to be the case 5 years ago, even. I mean, I teach it in my courses. I teach it in women in art, in American art. It is a part of art history.
Because it's not the work itself and the artist, what the artists are trying to do is not self-referential,
right.
I think, unlike art by trained artists, academic artists, the last at least 200 years, it has a hard time, academics have a hard time finding a niche for it in the standard progression of art history, and so it has a hard time, in addition to which very few of them have any training in that area, so it has had a very difficult time working its way into the academy. But Joyce's is one of a number of art historians and college professors in other disciplines who are moving this material into the academic mainstream and treating it as worthy of serious academic study, which is great to see and long overdue.
I think, and just my impression is the fact that they opened up the Museum of Folk Art right next door to the MoMA in New York, I felt gives it a place, you know, and gives it some longevity. Mm-hmm. Would you not say yes or no to that?
Yes, and they had a show. I think the Museum of American Folk Art had a show maybe over a year ago, but it's fairly recent, which was really one of these shows that mixed trained artists and they call them contemporary folk artists, around ideas of abstraction. Now, there's certainly a common theme. It could easily be trivialized, but that was a quite successful show, I thought.
Yeah. That's my question is, when these things are presented side by side, so to speak, how does that work? How is it going to work? And the fact that we even have to question including the two, you know, trained and not trained in a same context of exhibition, shows us that there is something we're not addressing between the two that exists. Mm-hmm. And that's what I'm curious about.
Well, it's
about.
Partly a shortcoming of, you know, art history is a socially constructed phenomenon. I mean, it grew up with its own history of what was, I mean, there was a time when photographs were not considered art.
So and sociology of art history.
That's right, yes. And but I think that there are
sense.
A lot of other, there are a lot of other, and this I think is a byproduct, not all of it, but certainly a byproduct of movements like feminism. I was talking about this, I guess it was with you earlier today, Xenia, that there's a huge and really fascinating literature now on material culture. That looks at some of these things, like the book by Beverly Gordon on saturation. She's interested in things like scrapbooks and paper dolls and studying them from a scholarly perspective, but without the adherence to these rigid categories of hierarchies of, oh, there's Henry Moore's bronze, and down here there's a paper doll. There's a very interesting exhibition, I don't know how many of you get to New York regularly, but there's a very interesting exhibition right now at the Brooklyn Museum of work by Kiki Smith, who is a contemporary artist, which is an installation of several rooms. She makes dolls and they're and figurines out of plaster, and they're described more as sculptural figures than as dolls, but the whole enterprise of the installation is based on a folk embroidery of a woman's life. And it's a tiny little embroidery that is in the exhibition. It comes from, I forget what collection, but it's an historical archive. And then she kind of uses that as her inspiration and spins off from it with all of these objects that she makes.
Louise Bourgeois comes to mind with her crocheted dolls.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And that's kind of a crossing of a threshold there. And the question of how the idea of abstraction is possibly differentiated between a so-called academic or a so-identified academic perspective versus a vernacular or self-taught is an interesting question.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, how can we say that there's a difference or how significant is the difference?
I mean, there are differences between artists within the different categories as well. Yeah. Yes, the status of the field is a gigantic subject. I mean, there is there's a chat group online, which, I mean, just gives me a headache, because you wake up in the morning and there are 600 messages from people, and the I forget what exactly it's called, but the self-taught artists chat group, and every time there's an exhibition, 25 people weigh in with talk about, oh, they shouldn't have called it vernacular, or they shouldn't have called it outsider, and it's the struggle for identity of the field is kind of awesome.
Xenia brings up a very interesting point. I mean, one thing I want to add to this is that don't forget Art Brut, Debuffet, and all of those artists were influenced by the art of the quote-unquote insane, and of children, of people like Nellie Mae Rowe. And so essentially they took that, if you want to call it vernacular, and gave it respectability. And so it's only a matter of time when actually people realize that this stuff is just as relevant as stuff that, you know, people of that time did to copy or to appropriate the styles in many ways and make it their own, of course.
What will ultimately happen to the exhibition or the collection of her work?
It's here?
Yes, I mean, period. I mean, you know, say years from now, or if it's still, you know, resilient, what will happen to it? Does it just travel from place to place, and then what happens to it?
Well, when Judith Alexander gave us 150 objects by Nellie Mae Rowe, in 2003 and 4. Did you know Judith? We had to promise a lot of things before we got that, all of which had to do with taking care of Nellie. And I'm sorry. I said we had to promise a lot of things to get that work, and all of which had to do with taking care of Nellie and making sure that she was going to get that her position in this museum would be prominent and that she would continue to get attention from us and thus from the rest of the world for some time to come. So, among other things, one of our commitments was to install a Nellie Mae Rowe room with Rowe's drawings and other Rowe objects. And keep that room dedicated to Rowe in the folk art galleries. In fact, we even had to keep it in the same room. The room is specified by number. And that, we had agreed to do that for 25 years. And forever, we have to agree to keep something of Rowe's on view in the museum. But our commitment to the work goes way beyond that. We have already put together one show that was shown out of Atlanta in Macon last year. Remember that? And we would love to put together, it would need to be a series of shows, because since most of these are works on paper, they're more fragile than paintings and sculptures. And so you can't, for example, put together a traveling show and send it on its way. You need to rotate those works. They need to rest after a while. And so, which is not a very long while either. And so, but despite that, we hope to eventually have a sort of program by which the Rowe works are going out to other institutions on a regular basis, groups of them. And we have had several inquiries from people in other institutions around the South who said, you know, at some point I'd really like to do a Nellie Mae Rowe show or to have a Nellie Mae Rowe show here. And another thing that we would love to see and almost certainly will eventually do is a catalog of the Rowe collection that's here.
Now, Lee Cogan did a fantastic catalog for her 99 and a half won't do show, but the group of works, it's a total of 180 works, because we already had 30 by Nellie Mae Rowe before Judith gave us the other 150. So we are hands down the go-to place for Nellie Mae Rowe. And we appreciate not only what a responsibility that is for us, but also what it does for the high. And so, you know, our hope is that this work continues to become more and more, become better and better known and more appreciated as that happens. And so the trajectory for Rowe's work is continually up and not, you know, not quite so wavy.
I have one last question. I did ask one member of the family earlier to describe to me what the quilts that she made were like. I wasn't able to find any reproductions of quilts. What kinds of fabrics did she use? Where did she get the fabrics?
Is that a crocheted Afghan?
Well, yes. Yeah, that's another question. Did she make this Afghan, or is that something that someone gave her?
I recall that her sister, my great-grandmother, was the quilter in the family. Uh-huh. She had several sisters that I was pretty familiar with because they would visit often, and I must say they were all very independent women before it was fashionable to be feminist or anything like that. But I think that they all quilted. I think that it was kind of an out of necessity as they were coming up. And I've seen many of my great-grandmother's quilt projects that I don't know, she may have helped her on, but I have not really seen any that Nellie Mae did.
Mm-hmm. And what are your great-grandmother's quilts like?
I don't have any of them left, unfortunately. Do you have any? No. But they were, she would use collected scraps, you know, that she would get from either her employer or just out of old clothing or all of these different things, and she would collect them over a long period of time. And she was trying to teach me to quilt as a little child, and I didn't pick it up very well. But she would make, you know, at least one a year, usually more. But quilting was something that was a pretty commonplace thing for them to do, but I never saw anything that Nellie Mae did.
I did, by the way, finally see, this is a signature, one of those, it's a painting that is, I mean a drawing that is, it might actually be on acrylic on board or something, but it is a signature, it's nothing else, so.
In reference to what becomes of the work, I just want to let you know, if you know already, I think, that there is a Judith Alexander Foundation, and there are three of us here tonight who serve on the board of that. And part of our mission is to make sure that Judith's legacy in terms of her support of Nellie Mae Rowe is nurtured. That's a big part of what we're here to do.
And they have a website.
It's judithalexander.org.
judithalexander.org. All right. Joyce, thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you.